Hello everyone, good evening. If you are in the United States, welcome to Tachi Talk. You know that the purpose of Tachi Talk is to have a very light, informal conversation with very nice people, interesting people all over the world. Today, we have Adriana with me. But before I introduce you and tell you how I met Adriana, let me just translate a little bit to my fellow Brazilians. Oi, gente. Aqui Tatiana novamente. Muito obrigada por estarem comigo e estarem em breve com a Adriana aqui no Tati Talk de toda segunda-feira. É um prazer enorme estar com vocês e ter a fidelidade de vocês em participar desse papo extremamente informal que traz gente interessante como você, como nós, para bater um papo gostoso. Eu vou fazer todo esse talk em inglês, mas por favor, não se acanhe. Se você não estiver deitando no inglês ainda, não se preocupe. A gente tem até aqui professores de inglês já com a gente. Manda sua pergunta em português, em chinês, do jeito que você quiser. Por favor, não deixa de participar por conta disso. So, well, guys, I was just telling my fellow Brazilians, if they are not very comfortable with English, they don't have to be ashamed. They just have to throw out their questions and all their comments in Portuguese, whatever. They can just throw out their comments the way they prefer. So welcome again. And let me tell you just a little bit how I met Adriana Machado. We were introduced by our very dear friend, Márcio, who is here with us. Márcio lives in Miami, as well Adriana. And one day I was having a conversation with him about leadership. And then he mentioned Adriana's name. And the way he told me about her, the way he just told me the amazing things that she has been doing for her whole life, I just fell in love. And then I just threw Adriana a message and said, do you mind to have a conversation with me? And then I understood why Márcio admired Adriana so much. And when I just invited her to come to Tachi Talk, she was very kind and she just accepted. And you know, Adriana has a very strong career in leadership. She's a former president, CEO of General Electric in Brazil. And now she founded the Braya Institute. But I'm going to let Adriana explain very much, much better than myself, who is her. So Adriana, welcome. Thank you for being here with me today. It's kind of very weird talking to you in English. Welcome.
Thank you, Tati. It's a pleasure to be here. Very nice to have this opportunity to share and to have this informal conversation with you.
Yes.
And so thank you for the opportunity. It is strange to be talking in English, but we both live in the United States and the world is now so globalized that,
yes,
it's better that we can reach more people if we speak English, I think. Right?
Yes, so, absolutely.
Here we go.
Yeah, and would you mind to introduce yourself in your own words?
Sure, sure. So who is Adriana? Adriana is, first of all, a mother, a wife, an entrepreneur in Miami. I have been very passionate about producing, promoting impact through business throughout my life, and more so now that I really switched the gears and started doing it with Braya Institute here in Miami. I'm a practitioner of systems thinking, and I'm learning as we go and applying it already to what we do, the projects we do in Braya. So I was born in Niterói. I was raised in Brasília. I had my first child in Brasília. Well, but before that, I studied political science. That was my background.
Political science?
Political science,
okay,
at the University of Brasília. And then I was an exchange student, too, in the United States. Back then, I lived in Oregon.
Okay.
And going from Brasília to Oregon was quite an adventure at that time. There was no internet. And the communication was through like regular letters to my mom and my family and very, very few phone calls. But that was very expensive.
Very expensive, yes.
Yeah. But it was a huge experience. I definitely matured a lot and learned a lot and fell in love with the American culture.
Yeah.
So after coming back and studying political science, I worked first for the Brazilian government as an intern. And then my first job out of college was for the U.S. government at the embassy in Brasília. So I did have this background working with both the Brazilian and U.S. government, and before I moved to São Paulo and started coming closer to the private sector. So first, when I reached São Paulo, I had no idea what I was going to do. And then I started working for the Chamber of Commerce, the American Chamber of Commerce, which is the largest chamber of commerce outside the United States, at least was back then. Mm-hmm. And then pretty soon I started becoming more familiar with the private sector's agenda. Mm-hmm. So going from government to private sector and then having the opportunity to work with two huge and inspiring multinational companies like Intel and GE was, mm-hmm. You know, paving the way for what I do today in at BRIA, so here in the U.S. So very nice trajectory so far. I can't complain, but I think that I'm, you know, still in the middle of what I have to do here. Okay. So I usually say that the best is yet to come.
Oh,
so
stay tuned. Sure. For sure. And I am very curious to understand, how do you became a leader? If we can say that, because some people believe we have this leadership running in our blood and some people doesn't have it. I have my own opinion, but I would like to know, since you mentioned that you were just studying here and then you came back to Brazil and work not in the private sector, and then you came to the private sector, where at that point you feel that, or you felt that leadership was running into your veins, or this is just a, you know, there's nothing like running in our veins, we just become?
Well, I think there is, the seed is there. If the intent is also there, you can become a very inspiring leader and use those abilities that everybody has to actually do something meaningful in your life. Mm-hmm. But back when I was in Brasilia, and you know, Brasilia, when you're growing up in Brazil, it's a capital city. Most people there, especially when I was growing up, work for the government. So the highest inspiration you can ever have is to become a public servant and work for the government.
Okay.
So if God came to me and talked to me and said, Adriana, you are going to become the CEO of General Electric in Brazil, I would say, come on, you're joking, right? No kidding, that can never happen. Because that's not something that you you aspire to when you are a young woman in Brazilian studying political science and working for the government. Mm-hmm. So when I moved to São Paulo, that I became a little bit more familiar with the private sector, and I saw all the opportunities coming, and it all happened relatively fast. But one thing that I totally consider important in my trajectory, and I think GE does that very well, is when I first started working for GE, the very first day, I got a kit that was welcoming me to GE and treating me as a leader. So okay. GE has policy. When you are an employee at GE, you are considered a leader, no matter what position you have, no matter how, you know, if you don't have a team, no reporting lines or anything, because you will have the responsibility to represent the company in your conduct, in everything you do. So not only, you know, growing in the ranks, but also you are the living role model of a GE leader when you are, you know, doing whatever you're doing, and also in your personal lives and so forth. So they really groom every employee to become a leader. Mm-hmm. So that is kind of when my you know, it became clearer for me, mm-hmm. that this is something you can learn how to be. Mm-hmm. You don't have to just have the most important position to consider yourself a leader. There are multiple things you can do wherever you are. And this is the approach I bring with me to BRIA. I what I try to do here is to inspire people to embrace their unique leadership journeys, because each one of us, we all have our own experiences, and nothing compares to one another. Mm-hmm. So one experience is not the same as the other. Mm-hmm. So we all have beautiful things that we bring to this life, and we all can embrace this leadership journey and do much more with it than we can think of.
Absolutely. And I am very happy to just learn that GE has this way to plant a seed. Because the way you were explaining, you were just in the public sector and that just thinking, how can can myself, can I be in the future a leader, being a woman in the public sector, doesn't match. And then I'm happy to know. And this just brought me to something that I read on your website, and I printed out here. So when you are explaining to people in your website what it's Bria, and how can I say right? Bria, it's the right way Bria. To say?
Right.
When you are explaining what Bria is, you mentioned that companies must align corporate purpose with culture and corporate strategy, and they need leaders with the right skills to set their organizations on the right track while making capitalism a force for good. So let me just ask you this, Adriana. If you could just give to someone, to everybody here, a tip, an idea on how to become a leader, even though you are not a leader in your position per se, because you were saying that GE plant on you the seed, although you were not, you didn't have a team to follow you. But how can people be a leader without having the position?
Well, usually people learn by seeing role models, by, you know, you teach by example. So the first thing, the first tip that I would give people is to be grateful for what you are, for what you have, for where you are, and really understand these unique talents that you bring to life and put them to work. Mm-hmm. So this is the beginning for everybody, and everybody will have a different trajectory just because Absolutely. We are different. Right? Mm-hmm. So understanding that you are unique and you can promote impact wherever you are changes the whole thing, because you don't have to wait to be in a position of power. You Yes. can exercise power wherever you are. Of course, it will vary, and there will be different situations, and environments will interfere as well. And the more I learn systems thinking, I get thinking, we are a complex adaptive systems ourselves, like our body, or, you know, everything works in a way that, you know, most of us cannot even explain. Companies are complex adaptive systems, organizations in general. So not only private sector, I mean, everything. Cities are. So if we are a whole where the parts are, you know, the sum of the parts is bigger than the individual parts, and there is synergistic effects. So what we do really matters. Our intentions really matter. So Yes. the more we understand that and apply those unique talents of ours towards something that is of greater inspiration, so of greater purpose, we can do amazing things. So I really challenge everybody to, you know, try and experiment and really learn about you, but also offer yourself, be of service. And you are going to be able to do amazing things, I'm sure.
Yes, absolutely. And you also mentioned in your website that we are living the way the World Economy Forum mentioned, that we are living in the fourth industrial revolution. And when I just read that thing in your website, just made me think about COVID now. And I would like to ask you, because we have a very clear movement of companies looking to change the way leaders look to their employees, exactly the way you were explaining. We are all a system. We have to belong. We have to use our small, not in a bad way to say, but our talents to make the system works. So I have been noticing companies making an effort to implement a different leadership. So right. I don't have a very clear opinion on it, because I was feeling this before COVID, and now I feel that COVID accelerated this positioning, this new way the leaders are looking to their employees. What do you think Right. about it? It was COVID, or it was happening already?
Oh, no, it was already happening, and many, many nice leaders, corporate leaders and whatnot. Have been saying this even before I started saying my website, as you were mentioning. But, you know, there is a need to rethink capitalism. We can't be this degenerative with people, planet, right? In order for us to continue to survive as a human race on this earth, we do need new narratives. And business can be a force for good. So this is not new. This was there before COVID. What the World Economic Forum also says in terms of responsible leadership is very important. The fourth industrial revolution with the technology that is emerging and the knowledge that we are now able to grasp and put our heads around allows us to really, you know, apply this in a different way. So we have combinations of technology and human thinking, right, to really produce good innovation. And if we can align it with a higher purpose, we can definitely produce results that are good for people and planet. I also there is a PhD that I admire a lot, and I've been reading a lot about him. It's Daniel Wall. And he gives a lot of TED Talks and speaks about it. And he even brings one very important dimension to this conversation. So John Elkington, a long time ago, coined the term triple bottom line, right? Profit, planet, people, or whatever the order is. But
okay.
This was not enough. And usually businesses were seeing sustainability as something that was separated from business. And integrating it has been a very, very difficult process, but it was happening before COVID. What happened with COVID is that it accelerated this process. Mm-hmm. There is now a more understanding that if we don't treat our people right, if we don't really focus on what matters, we're not going to survive all this crisis that, COVID is just an example of. Mm-hmm. And there may be other pandemics coming up with all the different things we've done in our systems.
Yes.
Now. So COVID accelerated the process, and we need to be mindful of that and accelerate the process towards more purpose and, you know, stakeholder capitalism, whatever name you use it. Mm-hmm. Some people use it, conscious capitalism, stakeholder capitalism, really being able to promote impact and positive impact to all the stakeholders involved.
Mm-hmm.
And what Daniel Wald says that I like so much, this fourth element, so besides the profit, the people, and the planet, is the worldview. So what we believe in, our assumptions, what we actually believe in shapes the designs that mm-hmm. we create. So the systems designs that we create. And up to now, the systems have been very degenerative. So it's time for us to switch this narrative, switch this worldview, to really understanding science, be able to apply this approach to this increasing complexity we have, and come up with solutions that are more regenerative, that are, he talks about designing not only with nature, but as nature.
As nature.
So there is so much learnings in what he is doing and what others are doing. So again, it was there before. We knew what we needed to do. With the pandemic, it just accelerated the process. And it's not fast enough. I think we have to make sure businesses really understand the power they have in their hands
mm-hmm.
to make a difference and provide all of this change that we need in the world.
I love the way you approach the word capitalism. Because we have a lot of unconscious bias. And although we belong to a capitalism society, Brazil and United States, for example, is the majority of people who are watching us now, we have this unconscious bias thinking that if I pursue profit, I am not pursuing people. And if I pursue people, maybe I should be a nonprofit. So I remember a conversation that we had before in which you were being asked if Brya would be a nonprofit, where Brya would be. And I like that we can be profit, we can be capital inside a capitalism, and we also can take care of people in a sustainable way. It makes sense.
It makes total sense. And the problem, I think why people might have some unconscious bias or some restrictions about capitalism is because we were told that capitalism only pursued profits and the rest was not considered relevant or important.
Mm-hmm.
But this whole movement of sustainability has integrated these two parts. And the more you can integrate it, the better you can see what I call the the potential for creating an impact economy, which is you are going to be looking for financial returns because that's how you're going to reinvest in
and
whatever
you're
doing.
There's no problem at all.
But you have to do that while you are promoting good impact for people and planet.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what the impact economy is all about. It's pursuing financial returns alongside social and environmental. So you can't dissociate one from the other. You
mm-hmm.
can't just pursue profits on one side and then have the leftovers and invest in the nearby church. Or you can't just, oh, because we had a good result here, I'm going to pay my employees a little bit better and over them some kind of incentive. No, it has to be integrated. The compensation of the employees has to be tied to those metrics that are also financial, environmental, social. This whole concept of ESG metrics that is emerging now very, very strong. And with COVID again, became very evident. The ESG is the social, is so critical. And more companies are going after those metrics. So understanding how you can adopt that to your business in a way that it makes sense, start somewhere, and of course, go beyond the compliance standard, go, you know, voluntarily a little bit higher, trying to really incorporate something that makes sense for you wherever you are. So again, this is an intention to integrate, and it's an intention to put your priorities where you can have the highest impact. And in doing that, you are going to generate financial return.
Mm-hmm.
And you can also decide how much you're going to invest and if you're going to pay your shareholders or whatnot.
Yeah.
So when I was creating Bria, I took a boot camp course at MIT to learn how to create a startup. And my professor there said that every entrepreneurship is social entrepreneurship. Because when you are creating a startup and you are applying entrepreneurship, you are looking for a problem to solve.
Absolutely.
So if that problem is big enough, and if it's a social problem, and you look at the different aspects of it, and you can offer a solution that people will buy, so you are going to make profits while you're solving a social issue, a social problem, or an environmental problem. And I think that is the new idea that is emerging, and more business people are understanding that, and society is understanding that. So
absolutely.
You don't have to have, okay, of course, charity is important, but you don't have to only depend on charity or the government to promote social benefits for people, a better society for ourselves, a
mm-hmm.
better, you know, climate for our planet. No, the money that corporations make can be used in doing that in a very integrated way.
Mm-hmm.
So we just have to have the intention, as I said, and apply innovation with purpose to good practice.
Perfect. I have a question here that I am going to bring it up in a sec, but I want to ask you because I'm very curious. Since you were a CEO yourself and you are a board member, you are connected with a lot of people, C-level and presidents and everybody who are making decisions in big companies. Also with Bria, your clients, I am pretty sure that are influential people. When you talk about intention, how do you feel that this is really happening? I don't have your video now, Adriana. Are you here? Let me see just... Oh, you are back. How do you feel this is happening? People are being pushed to have this intention, or the intention is coming from... can you hear me? Let me just wait, guys, here to see. Maybe she's not hearing us. Let me just check. We can see you, but we cannot hear you. Can you hear me? Sorry, guys, technological problems, it happens. Can you hear me? No. No. You are fine. So Adriana is just leaving the Zoom right now, and she's coming back. Just bear with me. She's going to come back. But meanwhile, let me just pull up here what Wellington just mentioned. Amazing. Profit is not a sin. It provides the means for social transformation society. This is perfect. Let me bring her back. Thank you, Lord. There we go. We have you.
Yes. Sorry, I think there was some call interference and then I lost the connection with you, but I'm back.
No problem. It happens. What I was saying is I just pulled up here a comment from Lord, who were with us here last week. He was saying that profit's not a sin, and I love that. And before I bring Pachi's question, let me just come up with what I was saying before. You were talking about intention, and what I want to know is, are you feeling, because you are very connected with people who have a high influence, the presidents and the CEOs, are you feeling that this new era is pushing them, or they are intentionally wanting to do this differently now?
If you have a little bit of everything, but let me give you some examples. For instance, the former CEO of Unilever, who just retired, Paul Polman, he created a movement called Inspire. I think that's the name now. I'm forgetting now. But although he stepped down from his CEO position, he's still working to promote positive impact in the world. So he's creating alliances, working with sectors, because sometimes it's hard for you as a company leader, a CEO, to make a decision only unilaterally. So you yourself, if the whole industry doesn't change, it's very hard, because you're going to be doing it against all odds and probably yes. being a pioneer, and that's very hard. But sometimes it just doesn't work if the whole sector doesn't hold hands and go. Mm-hmm. So what I see more and more happening now is the openness for collaboration.
Okay.
And in Oxford University, there is a professor there, I think Ian, I forget his last name now, I'm running a blank here, but he's talking about the moment we are in as being the new renaissance, where you have a lot of developments in science and knowledge, but you also have one more thing that Leonardo da Vinci and the other beautiful people behind us didn't have, which is this connectivity.
Okay.
So back to what the fourth industrial revolution brings us, this blurring of the different sciences coming together. We can connect digitally like we're doing now.
Yes.
So online, face-to-face, virtually with the whole world. So we can tap into the power of the collective much more easily than what Leonardo could do back then. Right. So if we really leverage this network, you know, embrace these challenges we have, like the pandemic and other pressing challenges in a systemic way, and leverage the power of the collective and collaboration that is different from, you know, the very protective kind of collaboration we had before, we are going to have much more power to change things.
Absolutely.
And this is what some CEOs like Paul Polman and others are doing. And I believe that, again, you don't have to be Paul Polman to make a difference. You can start wherever you are. So if you have a startup like I do, or if you have a big company, or if you are part of a team, or even if you are not with any reporting line for, you know, directly reporting to you, but you can see something and comment on it. We had a webinar the other day at Bria where I was talking to a good friend of mine, Renard Aron, who's written a book on the way that lobby has been democratized and now it's all digital. And we were talking about the rise of the citizen stakeholder.
Okay.
This is such an important thing for people to understand. So whatever happens in the world, you can get your cell phone, you can make a comment, that can go viral.
Yes.
So you can build or destroy reputations in matters of seconds.
Mm-hmm.
So people can express their opinions about issues and take stands. So more and more CEOs of companies, big leaders, are being pressed to take stands. And their opinion really matters. And that can change the whole ballgame.
Yes.
So again, it's a very powerful moment we're in. And many people are already walking the talk, setting the example, being role models, and we can learn from those leadership role models for sure.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, because we of course, sometimes social media, the way the world just runs, and then the way you said, you make a comment and it's everywhere in a matter of seconds. Sometimes it's kind of annoying, people complain, but I have a positive nature, and I think this moment that we have been living for a few years, Facebook or Instagram, they are not very new, but I believe this is making leaders to stand up. And making them standing up, it's making other companies stand up and making everybody to take a position and just make things happen. Can I bring Pachi's question?
Yes, please.
Let me see here. She is asking how to deal with a boss who has zero leadership skills and does not allow anybody to develop their potential.
Well, sometimes you can try up to a certain limit and give up, or you can help the boss, like you do reverse mentoring. That's mm-hmm. something I learned at GE. When you don't know something and you have to learn with a junior person, it's called reverse mentoring. And I applied that technique when we were launching some affinity groups, especially to deal with the GBTL community that mm-hmm. was... back then, it was something new for GE, and we were learning. So we learned from people who were feeling the pressure and had that in their skin to teach us. So sometimes, of course, some bosses don't like that. But there is always a way for you to empower the person and make the person see what needs to be done. And especially if you can make him, the boss, him or her, right, because it can be both, understand what really matters for the team, and that this person will benefit from having employees that are happy, that are growing in their career, in their functions, that the whole team will benefit from it. So, of course, you know, there are techniques that can be used. I remember when I was still at the embassy, I was given a course on how to manage your boss.
Okay.
And I think that helped me along the way. And it was funny because when I came back, I had a boss that I had, you know, a little bit of a
laboratory.
Yeah. But I did learn how to listen to him better. And that helped me a lot. Because once you are just seeing the negative aspects of a person, you don't listen with your heart, right? You are not putting yourself in a mode where you're truly listening. Mm-hmm. So especially when you have issues with a person, and then psychologists can explain that much better, and there are many reasons why. But if you can at least go beyond that point where you can listen, mm-hmm. I'm sure you will find common ground and go little by little. Like in Brazil, we say like the people from Minas Gerais that come pelas
beiradas.
So maybe, you know, that's an alternative. Don't go just, you know, hitting hard face to face, because that might not lead you anywhere.
Yes.
Of course, if you have the opportunity to find a better boss that will support you and offer you the opportunity to grow, that's awesome. But sometimes you don't have that option.
Yep. Yep.
And we just have to, you know, hope that the situation will change by you being an example, by you also listening, finding this common ground and working your way through, you know, the ladders the best way you can.
Adriana, I absolutely love this because we are talking about nonviolent communication, right? We could talk about nonviolent communication here forever, and it's not our topic. But I would say, Pachi, go with nonviolent communication. The way Adriana just gave you this tip, listen from the heart. Because when we try to, when we do it, we really understand or pursue to understand, have the intention to understand what is the other person's motives. Because we always act based on our motives, on fulfill our needs. And maybe this person doesn't have her or his needs met. And this is the reason that this person is not being a good boss.
And look for indication of, I mean, some data that will show how performance can be improved by doing what you want the boss to do, right? So you can offer him the options by, you know, don't tell him that you're doing that to him, but you do that in a way that he will acknowledge that as being good for the company, and eventually that will be applied to the team.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you very much for the tip. Let me just bring something that you have in your institute. I learned from there that you work with the three pillars of co-creation, and I noted here, you talk about innovation, you talk about practice, and you talk about purpose. How can you were in the beginning of our conversation explaining a little bit, but I want to go a little bit in depth on what does that mean, having three pillars: innovation, purpose, and practice.
So we already discussed a little bit of aligning with purpose, right? So when you are motivated by something bigger than yourself, by bigger than your just immediate needs, it is much more engaging and much more, makes you a better leader and also helps you create a better team. When I started working in the purpose, even before that, actually, when, you know, I was very young, I always heard people saying that it was important to invest in innovation. Michael Porter started saying that a long time ago. And the private sector always, you know, in the companies I worked for, Intel and GE, they're icons for investing in innovation, even in more so during times of crisis, because that's how you're going to kick back. So I learned very early in my career that innovation was very important. And I always try to apply that to my learnings as well. So if I try something that doesn't work, I am not going to get frustrated because it didn't work and try to make it work, but I'm going to try to see what is that I'm missing. So looking around and trying to see around the corners, applying the systemic approach that I always talk about. So when you are too focused on a problem, you're zooming in. When you step back and look at a broader perspective, you are zooming out. Right. So innovation is a little bit like that, too. When you are looking for different ways to do something constantly, you have that as, you know, part of your daily practice. This will allow you to bring different approaches. And there's another professor that I like very much from Harvard. Unfortunately, he died not so long ago, Clayton Christensen, who said that in order for us to really change the level of prosperity in the world, and not and break the paradox, because right now we have prosperity increasing in the world, but it's increasing more where you already have prosperity. So the gap between the most prosperous and the least prosperous is also increasing. And he said that you have to invest in one kind of innovation, that is the market creating innovation, because that brings a pull effect around this innovation that really helps improve prosperity. So innovation is critical. Even in times of crisis, the private sector has told us that, and we need to apply that everywhere. So in the public, private, and in our personal lives. Purpose is what drives us and motivates us. And the best practices is how you get there, right?
Absolutely.
So you learn by making mistakes. You learn by reading about different approaches. You learn by trying to apply that to your case. So try to cultivate this habit of learning from whatever is available to you and applying the best practices that you can, that you have at hand.
Absolutely. And when you speak about innovation, just came to my mind that a lot of people, maybe a lot of people who are here with us, we connect because we have this bias too, that innovation is something that just startups does. Just people who has this creative mind, it can be innovative. But you have a broader perspective on what is to be innovative. Would you mind to explore a little bit more? Because bringing to real life to people that are not maybe in bigger companies or even an entrepreneurship journey, how can we be innovative in order to contaminate and change this world one person at a time?
So, so if you work in a big company, you probably have a what we call an R&D department, right? So they are dedicated to producing research and development. And that is the reality of big companies. Startups usually don't have an R&D department, but they have that in their DNA, like you described, right? They are always looking for something that is technologically advanced, that will really bring the next way of doing something and being a breakthrough. But people can be innovative in their mindset and looking for different ideas, reading different authors, applying different approaches to problems. So if you try something that doesn't work, let's, you know, find a way around it and let's explore. Mm-hmm. And I find that systems thinking give you a lot of that, the opportunity to look at the unknown, welcome the unknown. And even though you don't know, right, what you need to do, but being open to new ideas might lead you to innovation.
Absolutely.
So it's a mindset.
Yeah, this is perfect. And this is something we experience living here in the U.S. because inside the companies, they just ask employees to take the chance and just try and just take the risk, you know, instead of being just with the same mindset forever. We have
this is an important point, if I might, Tati. There is an author called Jean Case. She is one of the co-founders of the Case Foundation. I think she's also the president of the board of the National Geographic Foundation. She wrote a book called Be Fearless. And in her book, she gives 5 tips that I think are very important. And it has to do with being more innovative and entrepreneurial wherever you are. So she says that in order for you to really be a change maker, and that doesn't necessarily have to be in a startup. That could be anywhere you work or you are this day. So you have to make big bets. So what is that? So where are you going to focus? You're going to focus on what you know how to do, that you know what the result's going to be, or you're going to try something new, yeah. Right? You have to take risk. If you don't take risk, what is going to happen? I mean, if you make a mistake, you're going to learn from this mistake. And if you do something pretty bad, you're going to be apologize and try to learn from it. And
go forward.
The third tip she gives is exactly that. Learn from your failures. Mm-hmm. And also go beyond your bubble. So get out and eliminate the blind spots and conquer fear. Let urgency conquer fear. Because if we're fearful, we're closed, and we're not trying new things, and we're probably going to be getting the same results.
Yeah, and this is fighting our nature, because as human beings, we are all the time protecting ourselves. Our brains are protecting ourselves to try something new, because we are afraid to die, we are afraid to get hurt. So I love this, because we got it.
Which is just good. You have to listen to that as well. That's not a bad thing. I agree.
Yeah.
It's trying to explore this limit, this boundary, and stretch yourself a little bit in a safe way.
Yeah.
And keep stretching yourself, right?
Absolutely.
And it doesn't have to be done in a radical way.
Yeah. We are ending. So we have just, let's say, 2 minutes. But if you don't mind, I would love you to tell us about the third pillar, the purpose. What does mean?
So like I said, companies are now making this commitment publicly. The Business Roundtable, all the CEOs that are signatories have committed to that. But how do you make that happen? So it has to start from the individual level. You can have the mission and the vision of the company decided by the CEO, but if you're not walking the talk and if the companies don't do what they're saying that they want to do, this is never going to happen. Mm-hmm. So the alignment with purpose is very important in all different levels. So it starts with individual, and it has to be authentic, and the corporations can do that. So that's what we're doing at Bria. And we launched a course online called the CEO Meet and Master that aims to do exactly that. So to show what matters from the C-suite point of view, mm-hmm. having people inspired to act towards that. Mm-hmm. So applying systems thinking, delivering results to all stakeholders, and really looking at the opportunities they have at hand in the companies or in the organizations that they work for to go towards aligning purpose and delivering this positive impact.
I love
building the impact economy.
I love that. Thank you. Thank you very much. Adri, your final words.
Well, thank you for being with us and watching. And if you're interested in learning more about systemic approach and how to align purpose to business, follow Bria in social media. Join us tomorrow for a webinar that we're going to have on how to apply systemic approach to business. So just, stay tuned and let's chat some more I think this is a wonderful opportunity, Tachi. So I wanted to congratulate you for your initiative of having these conversations with people. We need to build, to design these narratives that are optimistic, that are positive, that can do attitude, right? That can help people be inspired to use their unique talents and promote good all around them. So thank you for the opportunity to be here with
you. Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure and an honor to get to know you better. And I truly believe we are going to keep doing amazing things. I talk to you soon, okay? Thank you very much, Adri.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So guys, I want to say thank you for you, for your patience, for being here with us. Please subscribe to my channel because I am looking forward to have more than 1,000 followers to be able to do translation live. So if you are not very good with your English, just get to know, just know that when I achieve this amount of people following me, you are going to be able to hear people speaking in English and having it translated real time to Portuguese. Se você não está muito confortável com o inglês, por favor, me ajuda a chegar a 1,000 seguidores aqui no meu canal. Subscribe aqui, ó, no meu canal. E quando eu tiver mais de 1,000 seguidores, eu vou ter o privilégio no YouTube de ter a tradução simultânea. Então, se você não fala o inglês, você vai poder ter a tradução para o português. Thank you very much, you guys. Next week, we have Ronaldo Ramos. As you can see here, Ronaldo is the founder of CEO Lab. He's also a strategy VP with the Chamber of Commerce Brazil, Canada. And he's going to be with us talking about mentorship. Semana que vem, o Tachi Talk inteiramente, fully in português, com o Ronaldo aqui, um cara sensacional, que trabalhou como presidente, como CEO de várias empresas. Hoje ele é membro do board de várias empresas e vice-presidente estratégico da Câmara Brasil e Canadá de Comércio e vai estar aqui com a gente falando sobre CEO Lab, a empresa dele. Muito obrigada. Divulga, fala sobre o Tachi Talk para que a gente consiga ter a tradução simultânea e consiga democratizar esse bate-papo delicioso. Tô vendo aqui, muito obrigada, gente. Muito obrigada, todo mundo falando obrigada para Adriana. E vejo vocês na semana que vem, no mesmo bate-canal, na mesma bate-hora.